I've seen in patients with recurrent urinary tract infections, someone who's had like chronic infections, we often see something called cystitis cystica, which is the bladder's response to the chronic inflammation.
Just mentioned the cystoscopy. Maybe you can give us a bit more insight into what that is and what you use it to look for.
Sure. So cystoscopy is when we take a look inside the bladder to evaluate the lining. I've seen in patients with recurrent urinary tract infections, someone who's had like chronic infections, we often see something called cystitis cystica, which is the bladder's response to the chronic inflammation. And it's where you get sort of the cells just sort of heaping up on top of each other and forming almost these like bullae or little tiny like nodules. And sometimes you'll see that diffusely. And I've had some patients actually where I've seen that and we've done like a low dose nitrofurantoin, like a daily nitrofurantoin to prevent UTIs for 6 months, and then I rescope them and it clears, and it's pretty amazing. And then I've also seen, where we've found a discrete area of inflammation, and the tissue looks very ragged, and has almost formed like a plaque. And I had a patient where I biopsied the tissue and I actually demonstrated the growth of bacteria in the tissue. And I think that our ability to demonstrate the areas, like if we think that embedded UTI is a possibility, our ability to demonstrate that cystoscopically is, would be wonderful. The other thing, obviously, you always want to look for, especially if you have a patient who has irritative bladder symptoms and it's ongoing and they're not responding to antibiotics, I think you have to do a cystoscopy. You have to make sure there's no cancer in the bladder. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you may even find like endometriosis on the inside of the bladder. It's pretty rare, but that has certainly been found as well. And, people can have other, like if you do a bladder biopsy, people can have findings like an increased concentration of eosinophils, which, could be their symptoms are from increased mast cell activation in the bladder as opposed to UTI. So I think, I have a low threshold to do cystoscopy. I think it's important in the evaluation of somebody who's having, chronic painful symptoms from their bladder.
Are there any side effects that could come from having a cystoscopy done?
I think if we, I think it's actually a very safe procedure. Here when we do it, we use a very strong numbing jelly in the urethra. I often will dilate the urethra a little bit very gently so that when the scope goes in, it's not traumatic. So most of my patients don't complain of pain during or after, but certainly I know like I've had a lot of patients who've seen, other urologists and they've been really traumatized by the cysto experience because they've just sort of been laying there and then someone comes in the room and just puts a scope in and it's very startling and painful. And so I think it's, it just has to be done right. It's a very safe procedure. The risk of getting a UTI from the cystoscopy is about 1-2%. If you, like in our office, we're very meticulous about sterile technique and numbing and things like that. So I don't routinely give patients antibiotics for cystoscopy. There's a small risk for urinary tract infection. There's a risk for irritative symptoms afterwards from the instrumentation, which is usually temporary. And so I find that, the benefits of doing a cystoscopy certainly outweigh the risks.
And what percentage of patients do you actually find something on cystoscopy that you couldn't have found otherwise?
That's an interesting question. I would say in about 60-70% of patients, occasionally I have a patient who's having irritative symptoms and we look in the bladder and I'm like, wow, I don't see a single thing here that I would biopsy, that I would cauterize. It looks pristine. Most people will have a little inflammation at the trigone or something that we call squamous metaplasia, or they'll have, some area where you can tell, they've had a UTI and there's some inflammation of the tissue. Mm-hmm. you know, I think if you find anything on cystoscopy, again, it's a very low risk. So even if there's a small chance that, you know, cauterizing it or taking a biopsy could help with diagnosis or treatment, I have a very low threshold to do that. And, you know, and it's interesting because when I have found, there's absolutely nothing in the bladder, and the urines are coming back negative, no white cells, you know, no red cells, no signs of inflammation. Visibly, there are no signs of inflammation. In that patient, you know, I'm more prone to believe that their symptoms are from, you know, genitourinary syndrome of menopause, and we need to really focus our treatment on that.
Okay. Someone asked a question about bladder trabeculation. Can you explain what that is and if it is something that needs to be treated?
Yes, I can explain what it is. Bladder trabeculation is when there is a thickening of the muscle fibers in the bladder wall. And we usually see it in men. We often see it when the prostate is obstructing and creating an outflow obstruction so that the bladder muscle actually has to work harder to get urine out. In women, we actually tend to see it in women with overactive bladder. And so on the cystoscopy, you know, you'll see where it looks like there are these sort of like bands underneath the mucosa. And those bands are just actually areas where the muscular layer of the bladder, where some muscle fibers are just thickened. And in women, it correlates more with overactive bladder.
Is it a problem or is it just something that naturally happens in those cases?
I wouldn't say it's a problem. Sometimes you'll see someone who has like a severe degree of bladder dysfunction where their bladder is very trabeculated, and there are also something called cellules where the muscle fibers are so thick that the mucosa sort of pooches out in between the thickened muscle fibers. So sometimes you'll see that in patients who have a very bad like neurogenic bladder, if they've had like a spinal cord injury, or you'll see it in patients with very bad diabetes. So sometimes it can be a manifestation of a disease which is neurologically affecting the bladder. But in most patients, it's mild, and there's nothing, aside from treating overactive bladder or treating bladder outlet obstruction, you don't actually do anything about that finding. There's nothing that you would, you know, do to those muscle fibers.
One thing that has come up a lot more in the last 6 months and that we've been getting questions about is fulguration. And I know you've mentioned it before as well. So I was hoping that you could give us a bit of insight into what that is and how it might be used.
Sure. So, typically when we do a cystoscopy, when we look inside the bladder, we're taking a look around to make sure we don't see any tumors or stones in the bladder. We like to see that the area where the urine flows in from the kidneys, that we see nice, brisk, clear flow of urine into that area. And often in women who have had urinary tract infections, we can see areas where the bladder tissue has reacted to the inflammation. And so you sometimes see these small sort of raised nodules, and, you know, they don't look at all like bladder cancer, but you can tell that, you know, the bladder has been reacting to some process. And it's felt that, you know, the bacteria, like especially when we talk about embedded bacteria, that these areas, these nodules may be areas where the bacteria can reside. And so when you go in the bladder, you know, doing a cystoscopy in the office, it's not a procedure that's typically done under anesthesia. You know, it's an office procedure where you come in, go home, you know, 15 minutes later. You can use a very small instrument if you see these tiny nodules to actually cauterize them, which means you're essentially gently burning them. So if you think about, like, if you've ever had a skin tag or something on your face, you know, where there's something called a hyphricator, where they sort of, your dermatologist might like zap it off. They basically apply this electrical energy and it just sort of burns the tissue, and then it sloughs away. So fulguration is basically the same thing, where we're essentially very gently, we're doing like a mechanical sort of cleaning of that tissue. Philip Zimmern out of UT Southwestern has done studies showing that, you know, while it doesn't help in 100% of recurrent UTI patients, in about 50 to 60% where they've cleared these small nodules, those women have had less urinary tract infections. And then in the women in whom it wasn't necessarily successful, when they went back and did it like a second or third time, there was some additional benefit. So, you know, I think again, when we do that, it's a very harmless, risk-free thing to do. There's not a lot of risk in gently, you know, cauterizing these lesions. It's similar to, like I said, if you had a skin lesion that was zapped, or, you know, people who, when they develop warts, you know, you get the freezing spray, sprayed on the warts, and then the tissue sloughs away. So it's very similar to doing that. And it's very easy to do when the patient is there for cystoscopy anyway. So you're not necessarily performing, you know, an extra procedure, you're there. And so if you see that, there may be some utility in cauterizing those areas. And so, you know, I'm someone who favors things that could be beneficial, that carry low risk.
Is that a painful thing for a patient?
It feels, so sometimes what we do is we actually put lidocaine in the bladder for 30 minutes prior, which really helps to numb the bladder. And in that case, you know, you don't really feel it. Without the lidocaine, it feels like a little bit of a zapping sensation. Because it's really at the surface mucosa, you know, most patients, even if they feel it, even if they feel something, it's tolerable. If you have a patient where, you know, you do one or two and it's really painful for them, then you might say, you know what, let's do this under anesthesia. And that's also the benefit of having the patient awake, so they can tell you, you know, look, stop, I can't tolerate this. Or, you know, they can say, yeah, it's fine, keep going.
One of the concerns that has been raised around this technique is the possibility that scar tissue will develop, which can't be a good thing in the bladder, I assume. Do you think the risk of that is low, or do you think that risk is more in techniques where they're fulgurating whole areas of the bladder?
I think that that risk is high when you are resecting deeper pieces of tissue in the bladder. And if you're doing it in multiple areas, like if you're doing that diffusely throughout the bladder, then you do have a greater risk of scarring and fibrosis. But I think with fulguration, it's so superficial that I don't think you're going to end up with scarring of the underlying connective tissue. Now, having said that, I mean, some people have, you know, in those studies, he's doing mostly at the trigone, which is the entry of the bladder. But some people do have like diffuse, what we call cystitis cystica. And it's, you know, it's all throughout the bladder, and that's very difficult, like to, you know, get every single one of those areas. And if you see that, you know, to me, that's more a sign that the patient has really had like chronic infection. And that's a patient who actually more willing to put on a low dose daily antibiotic like nitrofurantoin. I've seen that where we've done that for 6 months and I've looked back in and it's actually, you know, getting them UTI free for that good period of time has allowed their bladder to heal, and you actually see resolution of the large majority of those lesions. But if it's a discrete area, and particularly, you know, the trigone, which is the entry area of the bladder, and you're doing a superficial fulguration, then I don't feel scarring is a major concern. And, you know, I think maybe we're embracing strategies that are non-antibiotic strategies that can potentially be helpful. And again, you know, I think there is very little downside to trying it.